Good evening. I'm Stesha Brandon, the Literature and Humanities Program Manager at the Seattle Public Library. As we begin tonight, I would like to acknowledge that we are on Indigenous land. These are the traditional unceded territories of the Coast Salish people, specifically the Duwamish people. We honor their elders past and present and thank them for the stewardship of this land. Welcome to our conversation with Nancy Pearl and Rónán Hession, presented in partnership with Dublin, UNESCO City of Literature, Dublin City Libraries, and Seattle City of Literature. Both Seattle and Dublin are UNESCO Cities of Literature in UNESCO's Creative Cities Network, and we've had the pleasure of collaborating on other international projects together, including a celebration of World Poetry Day. In addition to our partners in Ireland, we're grateful to our author series sponsor, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, and the Seattle Times for generous support of library programs. Thank you as well to the Seattle Public Library Foundation. Private gifts to the foundation from thousands of donors help the library provide free programs and services that touch the lives of everyone in our community. I have a couple quick announcements before we get started. Rónán's wonderful book, Leonard and Hungry Paul, is published here in the States by Melville House, and I'm happy to say that it's available through our friends over at Elliott Bay Book Company. They are open for limited browsing, curbside pickup, or delivery, and you can find Leonard and Hungry Paul, as well as all of Nancy's books, at their website, elliottbaybook.com. Also, after the program, we're interested in hearing from you. You received a link to a survey in your reminder email about tonight's event. We'd appreciate it if you took a minute after the event to fill that out. We'd love to hear what you think. Now, I'm delighted to introduce tonight's speakers. Rónán Hession is an Irish writer, musician, and social worker based in Dublin. As Mumblin' Defro, he has released 3 albums of songs, and his most recent album, Dictionary Crimes, was nominated for the Choice Music Prize for Album of the Year. His first novel, Leonard and Hungry Paul, was shortlisted for an Irish Book of the Year award and is the 2021 One Dublin One Book selection. Nancy Pearl is a best-selling author, librarian, literary critic, and devoted reader. She can be heard on NPR's Morning Edition and KWGS FM in Tulsa, Oklahoma, discussing her favorite books. Nancy's monthly television show on Seattle Channel, Book Lust with Nancy Pearl, features interviews with authors, poets, and other literary figures. And among her many honors are the 2011 Librarian of the Year Award from Library Journal and the 2011 Lifetime Achievement Award from the Pacific Northwest Booksellers Association. Nancy is the creator of the internationally recognized program, If All of Seattle Read the Same Book, and was the inspiration for the Archie McPhee Librarian action figure. Nancy is the author of a number of books, including most recently her novel, George and Lizzie, and her co-authored collection of interviews, The Writer's Library, The Authors You Love on the Books That Changed Their Lives. We'll talk first with Nancy about One Book, One City programs, and then Rónán and Nancy will talk about Leonard and Hungry Paul. Hi, Nancy.
Hi, Stesha. So nice to see you again.
Oh, so great to see you too. So, our colleagues in Dublin invited us to partner on this year's One Dublin, One Book programming because the One Book, One City program was first created by you at the Seattle Public Library back in 1998. So could you tell us a little bit of history about If All of Seattle Read the Same Book?
First of all, that's probably the clunkiest title of any program that we've ever done. And thank goodness the library has changed it to Seattle Reads. But it initially began, we got a grant from the Lila Wallace Reader's Digest Foundation to build new audiences for literature. And I have always been interested in the phenomenon of book groups and how book groups encourage people to come together, read books that maybe they didn't know about, maybe they hadn't read before, and how that kind of discussion can deepen a person's appreciation for a work of literature. You know, it can expand your interests in what to read. So based on that, that sort of long-held belief on my part, what we decided to do was pick a book and ask everybody in Seattle to read that book and then come together in public places. I mean, and to encourage independent book book clubs to read it as they would, but then have book groups, have it available so people could come to public places, come to different libraries to talk about the book. I've always felt that it's easier that strangers coming together, that reading the same book can really help differences kind of drift away so that we can really appreciate our common humanity. And it's easier to talk about hard questions when you're talking about it in terms of a book and not necessarily your responses to that. So that was the beginning. And the first three books we did, well, the first two books that we did, the first one was Russell Banks' The Sweet Hereafter, an amazing novel for book groups, for discussions. And the second one was Ernest Gaines', just a fabulous novel, A Lesson Before Dying. So that's a brief background.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you so much. And, you know, it's such a powerful program and still running today. And in fact, you know, we just announced, the Seattle Public Library just announced the 2021 selection for Seattle is Britt Bennett's The Vanishing Half. And mm-hmm. and we'll be talking about that in October of 2021. So that's also great. A wonderful book. So a little yes. plug for that.
Good choice. Lots well, to talk about it.
Yeah, yeah. Well, can you tell us, you know, it is such a powerful program and has spread throughout the United States and then also internationally, as we know, because we're here to talk with Dublin's selected author, Rónán Hession. And do you have any ideas or insight into why the program has spread so widely?
You know, I think it's because it's one of the, because no matter what size your community is, this program, this simple idea of bringing people together to talk about a book is just so easy to adapt to, and you can do as much as you want with additional programming. And people still write to me and tell me that their community has done this and this and this, and this is the book, and this was their ideas. And I'm just blown away by the different ways that communities of all sizes have adapted it. So I think it's the ease of adaptation. And then that belief, I think, that readers and people who love books have, that reading can develop empathy. And one of the things that I think worldwide we have a certain need for these days, even more than we did probably in 1998, was a sense of empathy and understanding for our fellow humans, no matter their ethnicity or race or gender or anything. We want to bring people together. And what better to bring them together than to talk about a book?
Well, I think that's very true, and actually a beautiful segue to invite Rónán in, because his book, Leonard and Hungry Paul, is a really beautiful look at that topic, I think. So
I think so too.
Yeah, welcome, Rónán. I'll disappear backstage and let the two of you chat.
Great.
Thanks, Tasha, and good evening, Nancy.
Good evening, Rónán. So let me start by saying that I loved Leonard and Hungry Paul. It's always so much easier to talk to an author when you genuinely loved the book. And I wanted to start by asking where these characters came from. I would love it if you would answer it in what came first for you when you were thinking about the book, developing the book.
Well, I think the first thing that came to me was that I felt I was pregnant with this early 30s man who turned out to be Leonard. I had a sort of general sense of this character who was a gentle sort of person, a person who wasn't prominent even in his own life, but he was carrying a vague melancholy. And I carried that around in me for a while, bearing in mind that my background is in music and I had no intention of writing a book. And eventually I decided I was going to write something about him every day until I got to know him. It was February 2017. I had a new diary somebody had given me with, you know, an empty diary is just screaming out to be filled. So I thought it was a, you know, a systematic approach to say, I'll write something every day and I get to know him. After the second day, I said, forget it. I'm just going to try and write a novel. Nobody can stop me after all. And as I went into it there, I began to get a sort of sense that there was a world I could build around him, that he was a type of person who had a sort of appetite to engage with the world, but just wasn't quite sure how, or certainly wasn't sure how to do it without becoming overwhelmed. And I began to realize that when you look to explore a character, one of the ways you can do it is to put them in situations with other people. That other characters will draw out different sides of your personality. They give the reader a sense of almost walking around a sculpture, because you're seeing them from different perspectives and different behaviors being turned on. And that's how I sort of put him in contact with Hungry Paul. Hungry Paul is a very self-contained person. He's I think almost at the point of obliviousness, but not quite. We find out that he's actually very self-aware. And the two of them then form a partnership where in a sort of autodidacts, as people who are sort of self-taught about the world, they sort of try and figure it out for themselves. They're not people who have sort of received wisdom as such. They're not people who are necessarily have been shown how the world exists. They've kind of just figured it out in this sort of idiosyncratic way. But nevertheless, there's a sincerity into them and to their curiosity. So they do it almost without ego. They're just genuinely trying to figure out how this whole thing works. And around them, I felt that a family setting, which I think in novels is such a rich thing to write about and almost inexhaustible. And so creating Hungry Paul's family, which I wanted to write about a happy family. I think there's a real convention in certainly Anglophone literature, I think, about building narrative around conflict. And I wanted to try something a bit different. Mm-hmm. And I also felt that it would work well based on my own experience as a child who would often show up at my friend's house and they would say, here, stay for dinner, or we're going out to the park, come with us. So I kind of related to Leonard's role as an adjunct member of Hungry Paul's family, where he has, you know, couch rights. Mm-hmm. He can show up and be included. So from there, the characters emerged, and I'm not the kind of person, not the kind of writer who will say, I need to know everything about this character before I start. I want to know what breakfast cereal they have. I want to know which Greek island they prefer. I like the characters to reveal themselves to me through the story, which after all is how we get to understand people in real life.
Yeah, I can really relate to that, to getting to know a character deeper and deeper the more that you write about them. Were there things that you, in the process of writing it, were there things that surprised you about either one of those men?
I think so. I think with Hungry Paul in particular, I think when I started writing him, I thought I knew who he was. And I think my respect for him grew as I wrote it. I realized that for the reader, the journey for most of the characters will be that the characters would start in a steady state. They would find that disrupted and have to find a new way of being after it. And I realized Hungry Paul was the exception to that, that it's probably the reader who changes.
Yes.
And I suppose he came to stand for the things in life that are overlooked, but are in some way perennial. And I think at a time of discordance and disruption in the world, we're inclined to give too much weight to what's changing and overlook what's not changing. Mm-hmm. And I think Hungry Paul stands for that. And I think it's really, as I wrote the book, I began to understand him a bit more. I do really feel that when you write a character, it's a bit like developing a photograph where, you know, initially you can see the outline and you think you know what the person looks like. But the longer you leave the image, the shade comes in, the definition comes in. And it's that patience with a character where just little connections, just, I remember having a conversation with my editor about, yes, we think Hungry Paul would definitely use a stubby pencil, you know, and those little choices that just help tighten the screws around the definition of the character. So I think he was certainly a person who surprised me.
when you finished the book and it was published, and we can talk about its honors in a minute, but when it was out of your hands, did you at any time feel as though you wished it hadn't been published because there was so much more that you could have had these men, or that these men would experience? Did you miss the spending all the time with them?
That's certainly true. I think when you finish a book, there is a slight grieving process. It's a bit like when you go to a wedding and you're at the table with someone who's just really funny and interesting, and you kind of go away afterwards thinking, weren't they a nice couple, that couple that were beside us at the wedding? And you'll never see them again because you're on the groom's side, they're on the bride's side. And it's a bit like that. I think there's a big part of writing books is knowing when it's finished. And I think in a book, you do get a sense. There is almost, there's a little voice inside you that keeps urging you to look at certain things. And when that settles down and goes quiet, you know it's done. Usually what happens is you make it one or two edits too many and you cut back, say, okay, I'm now spoiling the book, I need to go back. And I think there is that sort of sense. There's actually a recurring motif in the book. One thing the book has a lot of is hellos and goodbyes, which is something that I haven't continued in my next book, but and I think that there is a sort of sense that I like the way when a book ends, a bit like a poem, you know, where it doesn't say, okay, it's over, it's definitively over, we can all move on. It just leaves you in a new place. And I love it when people come back to me and say, I wonder what they're doing now. Or like, what does Leonard think of this, do you think? And people sort of, you know, tag me on social media. And I like that. I like the sort of sense that people could use their imaginations to bring the characters so fully to life that they sort of do feel they're tangible in a way.
Well, it's such a compliment to you for making these characters so real, for creating these characters. Or if you were pregnant with Leonard, so you didn't necessarily create, he existed and you gave him room to grow, right?
Yeah, exactly. I really feel, for me, writing is, I know we use the word creativity as a shorthand, but it's more like a channeling, I think. And I've been creatively active between the music scene and writing since about 1993. So I feel I've got to a sort of stable, respectful relationship with my creative side. And to me, it's always felt like there's something slightly mysterious about it. I'm not exactly sure how it goes, but when I'm in it, I sort of know what to do. Mm-hmm. And I think I really believe that writing and reading is a collaboration. I do sort of feel that a book is potential energy and it needs to be animated. And I always say that to readers, you know, if they say, oh, I really, you know, got Grace or Hungry Paul or Leonard, I always say, well, that shows your imagination's in good shape. You're able to take the instruction manual and construct your own Hungry Paul. You know, that's a sign you're in good shape.
Right. Well, the novelist and essayist Paul Auster, the American novelist and essayist, talks about that collaboration between writer and reader in one of his essays. And what he says is something like he deliberately leaves space for his readers in his books. And in the end, he believes that the book that they're reading is a collaboration between him and the individual reader, which is why book groups are so interesting, because everybody reads a different book, and the version of Leonard and Hungry Paul I read is influenced by my life and where I am at that particular moment and my mood and all of that. And the book that Stesha read, the Leonard and Hungry Paul that Stesha read, is her book. And I love the fact that you didn't end Leonard and Hungry Paul with a wedding or a death or some finality, you know, that you've allowed the readers to think, oh, you know, this is what Leonard is going to do next. Or, I just loved what you did with Hungry Paul and the mimes and you know, his great idea was just brilliant, I have to say.
Well, thank you. I think one thing I learned during the book was about kind people, right? And I remember seeing a story on the news about this guy. There's a particular congregation point for homeless people in Dublin, as there's similar points in every city around the world, where they go and they get various supports and services, etc. And there was a guy who used to show up there, and he was a dental technician. And what he would do was on these little sort of foam pads, take an impression of the gums of any homeless people who needed dentures, go away and make them and bring them back the next week, right, at his own expense. And there are other examples like that that I kept. Once you notice those people, you keep noticing them, and they all work the same way. These are, I'm not naturally a kind person. I sort of learned it from my wife, but I notice how kind people work. They just find something they can do and offer it to other people. So there's a guy, he doesn't know the detail. Homelessness is a very complex issue. Yeah. He doesn't have, I don't know what his opinions are or his political leanings, but he said, here's something I can do that other people generally can't do. So what I'll do is I'll offer it to them. And that's what Hungry Paul does. He has very, very limited skills. He's okay with that. He doesn't see it as a deficiency, but there are a couple of things. He's good at silence. He's good at quiet, and he sees its potential. And he says, well, there's one thing I can do. And he just offers that.
Yeah, I mean, the scenes when he goes with his mother to visit patients in the hospital, and his sort of knowledge and appreciation of silence, of quiet, comes into play with one of the patients there. I found that incredibly moving. I think I was talking to a couple of booksellers in the States about how much they loved the book and how they're selling it, how they're hand selling it to their customers, and what books they're comparing it to. And one of the books that Daniel Golden at Boswell's Books, I know you did a virtual program there, compared it to was Susan Cain's nonfiction book called Quiet, about being an introvert in a noisy world. What would you compare it to?
I think the book is probably heavily influenced by me emerging from a decade of reading children's books with my kids. Honestly, that's what I think the biggest influence. I think it's influenced by those books tend to have happy families. So for example, you don't tend to get children's books about the mother is drinking gin in the corner and the father is sleeping with secretary or whatever. Right. They tend to try and, because parents sort of believe in the family, they're trying to make a happy family. And the sense that the characters that are trying to figure things out. I think there's a continuity between my approach to writing music right into the book. So I think probably one of the reasons why it's not, you know, obviously in a niche is that it doesn't really come from a particular, doesn't come from the book world. I think it comes from me. I did my last album in 2012, so I had a 5-year period of wondering about stuff and I'd nowhere to put it. So the book ended up becoming that sort of vessel for me. And I think I began to understand silence and the importance of silence, because I think silence is often misunderstood, you know, and to me, there are sort of three main types of silence. There's the being quiet, which is just sitting quietly. There's the sort of silence where your mind is quiet. So you can sit quietly, but your mind is thinking the whole time. And there are times when you can sit quietly and your mind is quiet. That's a bit like Hungry Paul. When he sees a dog with its tongue sticking out, he doesn't take it any further than that. He just observes it. And I think the other type of silence, which is I think where creativity comes in, is that type of silence we have inside us that holds our sense of the profound, whatever that is. That sort of stillness. You know, when you listen to a piece of classical music, say, and you're not analyzing it, you're not thinking about it, but you understand it. You understand it's a beautiful piece of music that you at a profound level understand. And it's so difficult to describe because the conceptual part of your brain wasn't turned on for that bit. Right. And I think Hungry Paul appears to be in a world of his own, but actually he's actually quite connected. And not because he's particularly gifted or not, because he's particularly ahead of everyone else. He's just open.
You know, I'm married to a man who is a Buddhist, and Hungry Paul reminded me a lot of things my husband has said, and things, and the way he experiences things. And I think that for Hungry Paul and for people like that, things just are, you know, there's not, when there's a poem that ends, "When you clam, son, clam," you know, just do it. And you're in the experience right there. And there's something so admirable. Can you achieve that? I mean, did you aspire to Hungry Paulness?
Yeah, I think you know, that issue, that point of silence, it exists. You know, I think these days people tend to associate it with, you know, mindfulness and Buddhism, right, and Eastern influence. But of course, there's a deep tradition in Christianity of silence. Right. We have silent orders. The Quakers practice silence. Almost every sort of deep tradition, whether it's secular or spiritual, has involved some time. I think the creative state is like that. I think the creative state is a bit like swimming. You know, you're swimming in your imagination. It seems to be always there and alive. And it's just sort of sense, I think, that silence and those quiet things, that they're kind of non-eventful, or that it's a state of being in calm boredom, when actually it's a very alive state. And I think that sort of deep silence is where creativity lives.
When you were writing the book, where did you do your writing? Did you need quiet for it? I know lots of writers that I've talked to have written their books at coffee shops. And when I was writing my novel, I couldn't write it at a coffee shop. I actually went to a library and sat in the quiet room there and, you know, did the writing. What about you?
For the most part, I started writing at 10 o'clock at night. I work, I have a day job, as Stasia was saying. I have young children, so they would go to bed. So at 10 o'clock at night, I would start working in my kitchen table till about midnight or half past midnight. Yeah. And I did that 6 nights a week for 3 months, and that's how I wrote the first draft of Paul. But I also wrote it on flights over to Brussels. I also wrote it at the train station. If I had 5 or 10 minutes, I'd flip open the laptop and write a paragraph. And I couldn't edit like that. I need quiet to edit. Mm-hmm. But to write, what I try to practice is a sort of integration where my creativity doesn't have to be special, that it's sort of there. Like every time you make a joke, your creativity is sort of in the mix there. So I try and just stay, that it's always there and you can come in and out of it. Like I know I was reading something recently, an interview with the Japanese writer Yoko Ogawa, and she won the Akutagawa Prize with her first novella, which is the most prestigious literary prize in Japan. And she wrote it when her first child was born. And every time she changed a nappy, she wrote one sentence. Every time she cooked a meal, she wrote one sentence. And she says she's no more productive now, even though she's a full-time writer. So I like that idea that your creativity is always there. And so I'm happy to squeeze it in. And I think probably most debuts are written that way, you know, while people are doing other jobs and other things.
Right. Right.
So it's probably a good, I'm always wary of creating a specialness around my writing, because then it becomes like, if I don't have my lucky rabbit's foot, I won't be able to write this chapter. Or if, you know, if I don't have perfect silence. I think some of that, I think, can be a form of panic. You know, there's a sort of sense that, oh no, the ideas aren't coming. I need to, you know, change something external. But I think there's a lot to be said for just keeping your cool.
One of the questions we got from the audience was about the relationship between you as a singer, your music, and the creativity that goes into that versus, or how that fits with the creativity that it takes for the extended work of writing a novel.
Yeah, there are some, like my songs were quite storytelling. And I think I was the only one surprised that I went on to attempt a book. There are some differences. And as part of One Dublin One Book, I actually played, I did a performance of my music, which is the first time I've done it since 2014.
Wow.
So it's my, your question is really timely, because I'm really revisiting a lot of that stuff. One thing I will say is that I think there's a difference between, you know, they say something is an art form. I think there's a difference between the art and the form. So the creativity, the idea is the same. So, but the form is different. It's a bit like if you only speak English, all your ideas about language and your conceptual basis is tied up with the English language. And you think they're the same. You know, somebody says, what does the concept of ethics mean to you? You will say, well, it comes from the Greek word, whatever the Greek word ethics, and therefore means these things. So your whole idea is, then suddenly you learn Japanese and you realize, oh, I'm not using any of that form anymore, but I'm still expressing the same thing. And so likewise, when you move between music and prose, it's sort of helpful because you're liberated from, you know, they're different things. The art is still the same, the form is different. Oh, so I was confusing. So it stops you using a technical solution to a creative problem or a creative solution to a technical problem. There are some practical differences too. My songs were all in first person. The prose, which I only realized the other day, was in, are all in third person. Right. And I realized when I was going back, there's a song I wrote back in the year 2000, which I played the other day. And there's one tricky bit. And I just figured out a different way of playing it. I was like, God, I wish I knew that 20 years ago. But you can't do that with books. I'm never going to go back to Leonard and Hungry Paul and say, ah, do you know what? Because with songs, you're always reinterpreting. They're kind of constantly living. With a book, it's going back to your early question. I ever missed, think wish right. I could go back in. You're sort of stuck with it then. You know, it's not really a done thing that you will, you know, do cover versions of your own book.
This book was so, for a first novel, one, you know, had many honors. Including the one book, One Dublin, which I think is fabulous that this is the book, because I can see a lot of great things to talk about in it. Does that give you increased pressure about a second book or not?
I think there was a period when I started writing my second novel, which is quite different, where I sort of sat down, okay, how do you do one of these things again? And I start tapping away, kind of, it's almost like there's a bunch of people standing behind me going, oh, don't mind us, we're just looking.
Yeah, right.
But I think having been involved in music, I do think it's one of the charter of fundamental rights of the artist is the right to disappoint people. I think you have to, as an artist, accept that you have to respond to whatever the impulse is that's driving you to write, and you can't think too much. So I think in ways, when you're writing your second book, it's a bit like Lego. So, you know, you build something out of Lego. To build the next thing, you have to take that apart first and build something else. You can't just add on to your initial building. So I think it's helpful to sort of go back to the beginning and to clear a space and say, okay, this is a new project. It's not a continuation. Mm-hmm. It's not trying to meet that expectation. But at the same time, you trust that your heart was in the first book. If your heart was in the second book, the people will recognize that. And also I think, you know, reading is such a big part of being a writer. So just a big part of my life that, you know, I trust readers as well. You know, I think people who read and who are interested and curious and patient will be up for something different. And I would never, it's always good to assume your readers are smarter than you are. So then you're not just saying, well, they like the cuddly book in Leonard and Hungry Paul, I'll give them another, something in the same frequency range. You say, no, look, I'm assuming that if I'm able for it, they'll at least be able for it.
One of the interesting things that I found, and Daniel Golden also talks about this, I think, is that this is not a book with a big sense of place, that it could be anywhere. It could be set anywhere. And I thought that was very interesting to me. Place is not important to me as a reader. And so I appreciate it when, I appreciate that when a writer doesn't necessarily set it in a particular observable, knowable place. Was that a deliberate decision on your part?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the book is supposed to feel not far from here and now, wherever that is for the reader. Mm-hmm. And it's part of a general approach in the book that it's pretty signless. So there are no surnames. There's no specific location, no specific time period. There are very few physical descriptions. And one of the reasons for that is the primary focus is on human nature, and particularly parts of human nature that get overlooked. If you bring all that stuff back in, immediately the reader starts taking, without being conscious of it, shortcuts to say, oh, I know who this person is. Oh, I know where this is. I know, I get who this is. So it forces the more subtle sides of the personality to the fore a little bit. And also I think being from Dublin, Dublin's a big character to put in the book. Dublin has a lot of history, a lot of baggage. If you're going to put it in there, you better do it right. And I felt that would just dominate the book a little bit.
Yeah, and there's a lot of Irish writers who came before you that did Dublin, that when we think about Irish writers, James Joyce comes to mind, for example.
Yes. Exactly,
Yeah, that kind of thing. When you're reading, when you're looking for something to read yourself, what do you look for?
I think I always look to read something I haven't read before. The type of book I haven't read before. I read a lot of fiction and translation. Overwhelmingly, I review translated books for the Irish Times as well. The 95% of the people in the world come from countries where English is not the first language. So to get a balance, I like to read broadly. I'm particularly drawn to Japanese literature. I also enjoy Egyptian writers from Sudan, from Eastern Europe, American writers, of course. But really what I'm looking for I try and open myself for a book. I think becoming a writer has made me realize that people don't just react to a book, they always project onto it as well. And I try not to do that. I try as best I can to say, okay, you have me now for the next 8 or 10 hours. I'm in your hands, and just to trust myself to the book. So to try not to arrive with, I don't like childhood books. I don't like coming of age books. I don't like books with puddles in them or something, to try and say, well, what's the writer trying to do? And I don't actually read analytically. I don't take notes, or I just let it soak into me. And then afterwards, I like to see what sort of floats back to the surface of my mind. So I try not to be prescriptive, but I'm very impressed by the standard of fiction, of international fiction in the world today. I think there are many, many writers who are really, really talented and who deserve a wider readership and wider attention. And I think it's improving, things are improving.
Why do you think so many people feel that a translated book is too much trouble?
It's not like foreign films where somebody might say, I don't like subtitles, I want to look at the screen. The book is available in English. You would think that if you were picking up a book by Banana Yoshimoto and a book by Paul Auster, they're both in English.
Right.
Sometimes people will say, well, a translation is a bit secondhand, but what's the alternative? And in fact, translators themselves are real artists, so you're getting something pure. I think there's just a resistance. Some of it's to do with the industry. I think I do think where international fiction is sometimes treated like a genre. I think a lot of the publishers, some of the publishers who are involved are quite small. The risk-taking publishers, the award-winning publisher in international literature, tend to be the smaller publishers. So they don't have the sort of commercial clout. And some practical things. If you wanted to do this interview with, Miko Kawakami, now she does speak a bit of English, but you might say, well, can't you handle the interview? Will we have to kind of keep it simple? Can't even travel to do events? There's all practical things like that. Mm-hmm. And there are just some huge biases, especially in gender, where I think only 5% of fiction sales in the UK are fiction and translation, and only a third of those are by women. So you have, about 3.6, 3.7 billion women in the world who are being represented by about 1% of fiction sales. So there are all sorts of quirks, but there's also, I think, a very enthusiastic movement, particularly through social media, to overcome that. You know, like August is Women in Translation Month. There is increasing focus on the great work independent publishers are doing. And I think things will improve. One thing I'm particularly conscious of is that there are a lot of 20th century authors who are very successful in their own language, but are in danger of slipping out of public consciousness. And that's, if I won $1 million in the morning, I'd love to set up a publisher to deal with that.
Yeah. Are you learning Japanese?
I am. Yeah, well, only on Duolingo, so I don't want to overstate it. And please don't ask me to say anything other than point with my finger at what I think the right answer is. But yeah, it's funny. I mentioned Yoko Ogawa earlier on. Her novel, The Memory Police, which was nominated for the International Booker last year, was first published in Japan in 1994. So even if it takes me 20 years to learn Japanese, I'll still probably read new Japanese releases quicker than if I wait for them to be translated.
Right. Now, what about that book, The Marioka Sisters?
Oh, The Marioka Sisters. Yeah, I have it here behind me, actually. Yeah. Tanizaki.
Yeah.
Yeah. I haven't read this yet. A good friend of mine who knows a lot about Japanese literature said it's his favorite Japanese book. So I have it lined up actually for Women in Translation Month. Every January I read Japanese. I do Japanuary. So I just read Japanese stuff. So that was on my list, but I bought too many books as usual and didn't get to it. So it's sitting behind me as a classic. Have you read it or do you enjoy it?
It's amazing. I think you'll love it, actually. I think it's exactly your kind of book.
Yeah, I read something, well, I'm probably not allowed to talk about it. I read something recently, which is for a review, which will be published next month, which is a modern sort of retelling of it. So I'm interested to go back and read the original. But yeah, it's a classic, and it's one of those gaps in my reading I need to do something about.
So in a way, you have this, you know, you wrote this wonderful novel, and you read in a way that I imagine Hungry Paul would read, right? That you're not, you know, that, I mean, you're not Hungry Paul and you're not Leonard, but I think as writers, we take bits and pieces from different people to make up the characters. One of the things that we talked about a little bit before the interview began, that you had pulled out some books that you thought needed to be better known. Could you talk about that?
Yeah, and thanks for an opportunity to talk about it, because I know you've been a real champion of overlooked writers. And I think it's fantastic when somebody has a platform and uses it in that way. It's such a powerful thing and it can make a huge difference. So just a few books. One is, and it probably has a different cover in the US, is Blue in Chicago by Betty Howland. So Betty Howland, I know she was published really back in the sort of 70s, really published three books, and was her reputation, she basically didn't maintain her profile. She was somebody who struggled with writing and with all the pressure in her life, but was rediscovered by a public space magazine or republished some of her stories. And that led to a resurgence of interest in her. And last year she was published in the UK and Ireland for the first time. And so this was our first opportunity, beautifully produced book, short stories and a novella. And in terms of a writer who can write at sentence level, you know, we're quite used, I think, now to writing that sort of looks out the window in the middle distance and kind of slowly gets us going. Her sentences are so surprising. They're electric. And then when you read it, it's very hard to put it all together. She's just a really incredible writer.
I think she reminded me of Grace Paley, another American writer from the 60s. I think I read Grace Paley back in the 60s, but at the sentence level is, I think, a great way of looking at that.
Yeah, fantastic. She has a memoir as well that has been published and is just coming out in the UK. So I'll be top of the queue to read that. And I think anyone studying writing should read her and reread her. Another one is Harumi Satouchi, who's a Japanese writer. Oh. And this is part of, you probably can't see, but this is Kodansha Press, who are not that well known in Europe, but I know I bought this secondhand from the States, so I know that they're more prominent there. They ran a very interesting series in the late 80s, early 90s called Japan's Women Writers. And Harumi Satouchi is The End of Summer was a beautiful book, and really, really modern feeling from the beginning of the 70s about women who were really pushing back against the conventions. Like, Japanese society is still quite old-fashioned in terms of gender roles. And she herself is a very interesting person. She's 98. She's a Buddhist nun. So she gave up writing to become a Buddhist nun. So she's as fresh-faced as anything. And actually, I bought another one of her books called Beauty in Disarray, which just arrived this morning from the US. So again, the type of writer who really should be very, very well known, but is not. Another one I have is another Japanese writer called Teiko Kono. And this is called Toddler Hunting and Other Stories. It's been published with a different cover, I think, in the US. This is from New Directions, so possibly the US cover. This is a great example. Not only is she a brilliant short story writer, and I think she's very influential actually on people like Yoko Ogawa who are around now, but she's also got a great translator here in Lucy North. And what I didn't really realize when I started reading translated fiction is how much work translators do to get writers published. They are really champions behind the scenes. So that's a great collaboration. And I might just do one more, or I can do more of them, but this is a book that I think it's called Shetetl Love Song by Grigory Kanovich. Wow. He is, this guy to me is sort of Nobel standard. He is a Lithuanian writer. I think he's in his late 80s or 90s now. And he writes all about the Litvaks, in other words, the Lithuanian Jews who more or less been wiped out at the end of the Second World War, and their whole life. There's great humor in it. It has one of the best descriptions of baldness I've ever read. I have a personal interest in that. He described a man was as bald as a knee, which I thought was really. So I have a few more here, but probably that's enough for now.
I'd love it if we had more time because those are so interesting, and many of them the Shtetl Love Song sounds great. But so many of the books that you were talking about are short stories, the Betty Howland collection of short stories. Are you interested in working in that?
I don't think so, not for now. Last year, last August, I published a short story in the Irish Times called The Translator's Funeral. And that got a really nice reaction. It was longlisted for the short story of the year. So I was encouraged by that. When I sat down to write it, I thought, well, I used to write songs. Short stories are just kind of a hop, skip, and a jump from that. But I said, what do I do? So what I decided to do was to write a 2,500 word novel. So that's what I did, called The Translator's Funeral. So I think that's something I may revisit. To some extent, Leonard and Hungry Paul, and also my second book, which is out next month, they are written in a vignette style. So the chapters are kind of short story based, where they are standalone sort of scenes or standalone sort of set pieces. So maybe it's something I'll return to, but it's not something I'm working on.
Yeah, yes. Well, Rónán, it's been just fabulous talking to you. Congratulations on writing Leonard and Hungry Paul and on all the success that you've gotten. And we can just say, look, we're looking forward to your next book and wherever that might take you, and reading that next book with an open mind and a sense of welcoming it into our life without judgment at the beginning. Is that fair to say?
That's fantastic. It's been an absolute joy to talk to you, Nancy. Exactly like you said earlier, you put two readers in a room and you can't shut them up, even though we say we're fans of silence. So that's
right.
A really enjoyable conversation, and it's been a real pleasure meeting you and talking to you.
Good. I hope our paths cross again.
I hope so too.
And here comes Stesha.
Oh, it's been just such a pleasure listening to you talk, and I loved the Housekeeper and the Professor, the Yoko Ogawa novel, and love The Memory Police. So I was like, oh yay, shout out for those. That's great. Well, thanks so much to both of you for being here. And I want to let viewers know that Ronan's wonderful book, Leonard and Hungry Paul, is available from our friends over at Elliott Bay Book Company. They're open for limited browsing, curbside pickup or delivery, and you can find it as well as all of Nancy's books at their website, elliottbaybook.com. And of course, you can also read Leonard and Hungry Paul or George and Lizzie or Nancy's other books through the library as well. And our URL is spl.org. And finally, we'd love to hear from you about how you felt about tonight's program. You received a link in a survey in your reminder email about tonight's event, and we would appreciate it if you took a minute after the event to fill that out. We'd love to hear what you think. We're so grateful to everyone who made tonight's program possible. Thank you to Dublin UNESCO City of Literature, Dublin City Libraries, and Seattle City of Literature. We're also grateful to author series sponsor, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, the Seattle Times, and the Seattle Public Library. And of course, thanks to all of you for joining us tonight. We'll see you next time.